So it sounds like both the context of where taking this drug and also potential genetic interactions, people that are predisposed to other, you know, brain dysfunctional disorders, those are the two major, you know, what seems to be, at least what we know now, things that predispose people to having a negative effect. How do you, when you're selecting your sample population, so how do you, you said you spend 8 hours with the person, is that like part of the selection process, or how do you figure out
who so just in terms of screening people into our protocol, we do extensive medical screening and then a history screening, and people are screened out if they have any even second degree relative with history of psychotic disorder or bipolar disorder.
Okay.
So we're conservative in that regard, but we're concerned with that as a vulnerability. In terms of whether people have difficult experiences, we can't protect against that. So even under our conditions, where many people have these greatly valued experiences of transcendence, some of those same people may have experiences that would are classic bad trips, that are excuse me, experiences that are among the most challenging and difficult of their lives. The difference in this context is that we can support people through those experiences, and sometimes those experiences can be a very short duration. Sometimes they can open into experiences of great insight or transcendence. And for some people, the very fact that they've had components of that difficult experience makes their overall experience more meaningful. But we have about 30% of our volunteers who will describe, at least for some duration of time, experiences of significant fear or anxiety come up. So we have not learned how to eliminate those. We don't even know whether they should be eliminated, because we don't understand the processes that are underlying the nature of these experiences that seem to be so important. And furthermore, I can say that our ability to predict who's going to have a difficult experience or not is almost zero. I mean, so in spite of the fact we get to know these volunteers really well, and at this point we have treated over 260 people with psilocybin. We have experience of over 570 sessions with psilocybin. So we have a lot of experience. But if we ask the clinicians that are closest to the volunteers to rate the probability of difficult experiences, their ability to predict that is almost none at all. So we don't really understand.
What about dose? Does dose play a role?
Oh, dose plays an important role. We know these effects are dose dependent.
All the effects, including the mystical experiences.
Yeah. And so we've gone up to, our highest dose is 30 milligrams per 70 kilograms, which is a
body weight
high dose of psilocybin, and the phenomenology of the types of things that'll occur with psilocybin are, as you might imagine, dose related. We've gone down to doses of 5 milligrams, and I suspect that there are threshold effects lower than that. And the probability of mystical type experiences and challenging experiences also increase as a function of dose. What's kind of interesting is that the probability of the very difficult experiences increase pretty significantly between 20 and 30 milligrams per 70 kilogram. So if we dose people at about 20 milligrams per 70 kilogram, we're much less likely to have the very challenging experiences. And with the cancer study, for instance, the dose that we used most often in that was 22 milligrams per 70 kilogram. So we were holding it back from our full-on dose.
Yeah, I would imagine that having a really stressful experience like being diagnosed with cancer would also, the stress that you're experiencing, obviously that's what you're partially trying to treat, but would also maybe shape the experience you're going to have in a way.
Well, and that was one of our questions going into that study. In spite of the fact that there was previous data suggesting efficacy, I was concerned, frankly, that this is a vulnerable population. I mean, they're depressed, they're anxious, they're facing the big existential question. And I was concerned that perhaps some of these deep experiences of the existential emptiness and fullness might end up potentially traumatizing some, at least subset of those people. Maybe they would come out worse for it. And I was concerned about that. Happily, the answer is that we have no indication that happened. In the 51 volunteers we treated and the 29 that were treated at NYU, we have no indication that people were harmed by these experiences. But that was a concern initially, and it led us to want to give a somewhat lower dose. And that dose, as it turns out, worked just fine.